And I want to show you a quote here. This is not the quote from a plaintiff's lawyer or someone involved in suing nursing homes. This is the quote from the medical examiner who assisted the state's prosecution. We now have the criminal law as a weapon against poor long-term care nursing care. Now, if that doesn't get your attention, I don't know what else I can say that might. That is truly terrifying. So, what do you do? The simple and logical first answer is, well, what can I do to avoid being sued? I'm going to do everything I can to do that, and I'm going to start with providing the highest quality care I can. And I would say to you that is exactly the right first impression, and that is exactly the right place to start, but that won't get you there. Interestingly, the University of Michigan did a study about a year and a half ago where they looked at wound care litigation in the state of Michigan. They looked retrospectively at lawsuits that were filed over pressure ulcers and other wounds, which predominantly involved long-term care facilities. And here's what they found, looking back retrospectively at the cases. Nearly 2 out of 3 of those cases did not involve a discernible act of negligence, a discernible error or omission in the care, and yet those cases were filed. Now, it doesn't mean the plaintiffs won all those cases. It doesn't mean they all went to trial. It doesn't even mean they all settled, but they all were filed, and every one of those institutions and every one of those healthcare providers had to go to the time, the expense, the aggravation, the embarrassment, the stress of being involved in the legal process. So what can you conclude from this? Quite simply, improving your care will only go so far, and it will not in and of itself eliminate or even sufficiently minimize, in my judgment, the legal and the medical legal risk you face inherently because of the fact that you're in the long-term care business. So, what do we do in addition to improving the quality of our care? A couple years ago, when we were working on the paper that Sue mentioned, we came up with the idea of preventative legal care. This was kind of a takeoff on the advice that the medical community is constantly giving non-medical people, which is to really engage in preventative medical care, really look at things prospectively. A couple of years ago, I guess it's been a year and a half ago now, I was privileged to speak at another one of these conferences that Medline put on in Washington, D.C., where Tom Daschle spoke. And when speaking about the healthcare system in this country, he talked about how we have a pyramid that's inverted. He said we really should have a pyramid where the broad base is on efforts and money and resources towards prevention, and the narrow tip is on treatment, is on actual treatment of illness and treatment of acute disease, when in actuality the pyramid's the opposite, and that's the problem in this country. I liked that analogy so much I've stolen it, and I've used it every time I've spoken since I heard that, because I think it applies equally well to how we handle medical legal risk in this country. Instead of having a pyramid where we spend lots and lots of resources trying to prospectively prevent medical legal risk, we spend an enormous amount of research of resources and time on legal fees and on settlements and on trials and on depositions and on all of the associated expenses that go towards actively, aggressively defending lawsuits once they happen. So what we wanted to propose is that healthcare providers take a more prospective approach to managing litigation risks. Now let me stress, overall, this is not a substitute for improved clinical care. This is not a lawyer up here trying to tell you how you can weasel out of being responsible if you provide bad care to some of your residents or some of your patients. What I am here to try to suggest to you is that there are certain things you can do to minimize your litigation risks that are not directly associated with the quality of your care. The litigation risks that led to those 66% of the lawsuits in the University of Michigan study that I just showed you a little while ago. So, in a nutshell, what are we talking about with preventative legal care? In the time I've got, I can just talk about some of the basics, but I do want to hit on 3 very important topics: communication, documentation, and mitigation. The first thing when you think about preventing a lawsuit is you really need to understand how a lawsuit develops. How does someone get to the point where they file a lawsuit and they sue a long-term care facility. Well, there's really two timelines to think about. There's the treatment timeline, where you have an admission, and then you have a key event. If you don't have an event, you're not going to have a lawsuit. No one goes home happy and suddenly decides they're just going to sue just because they just want to sue somebody. The event's recognized, people are notified of the event, there's treatment, and then there's a discharge, or in some cases, if the patient expires, there's a death. And then you have a medical legal timeline. After the event occurs, you're going to have doubts, you're going to have concerns, and then at some point, you're going to have consultations with other people, an investigation, potentially the retention of a lawyer, and then the filing of a lawsuit. I'll submit to you, in my experience, if you have an event, if you have that treatment timeline, it's almost impossible to stop doubts and concerns. That's going to happen anytime you have anyone who has an event happen to them or has an event happen to a loved one that they care about. But what you can do is you can break that medical legal timeline before consultation occurs, specifically before consultation occurs with a plaintiff's attorney. Because keep in mind what the answer is going to be that the plaintiff's lawyer is going to give if he or she is consulted. The answer is going to be, this happened because your mom was treated like cattle. The answer is going to be, this happened because they put money first. So ideally, that's where you want to break the chain. And the way you break it, if at all, is really through communication. It's very important to understand what really drives patients to go seek out lawyers. Certainly, I'm not here to tell you that this is not a motivating factor in some cases. And in some cases, it's the primary or the exclusive motivating factor. But in my experience, and I've handled thousands, literally, of lawsuits over nearly 17 years of practice, in most cases, the primary factor is a search for answers. Something has happened and they don't understand what, or they don't understand why, or both. And they want to understand. They have to understand. And keep in mind, this is the type of search for answers that doesn't just stop. It continues until a satisfactory answer is provided. Nobody goes home at the end of the day and says, gosh, you know, I meant to find out why mom died in that hospital. I just didn't get around to it. Maybe tomorrow. It doesn't work that way. When you have this type of question, they will continue to look and continue to search. And if you don't provide the answer, they're going to go to somebody who will. And you may not like the answer that that third party provides. This is especially an acute problem in long-term care because long-term care and end-of-life in general involves issues that people just inherently do not understand.